How are the Zip Hubs? Durian Rider, another YouTuber, doesn't seem to like their quality too much.
Hub, as this is the sort of the gold standard out there, and we'll just position it up like that. And you can sort of see here we have this is zip quality, and this was sent back for warranty, but I didn't get any warranty love. I'd sent it back too late. I'd been traveling and, you know, stuffing around like that, so I should have sent it back earlier, but they said no warranty, which is sort of not too bad, because even if they did warranty, they'd just give me the same hub again.
I'm a Zip fan, so I can tell you that the first the previous generation 188 hubs are loud. Okay, I never had big problems with it, but you always need to tighten them once in a while because they tend to loosen up.
Welcome back to another video, guys. Today we have a S-Works Venge. I'm here with an anonymous rider. You might know or might not know him, but he's a veteran in the cycling industry. So thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Lovely bike. I have the same bike. I wanted this color. This is the 2021 S-Works Venge. Maybe I shouldn't do the talking if you don't mind running through the bike.
So, okay. So this is a 2021 S-Works Venge. It's a size 52. It's spec'd in this grey, which is a 2021 colour. Comes with SRAM Red AXS 12-speed, which is ubiquitous in some of these bikes nowadays. Comes also with, it's a build from, I got the frame, and then from there I built the whole bike up from scratch. So had to get the Aerofly 2 handlebars with a Sella Italia SLR saddle, which is one of my favorite saddles. It's a saddle I go to. It's a little bit different from the normal strand braid because it has a different crank. This has a Roto 3D crank with a power to max type S power meter and carbon TI chain rings, which is something that it makes the bike a bit unique, but at the same time, it took a long time to get it because of the current situation. Actually, when I first got the bike, I was actually planning to run the Zip 303S, and then I was talking to the local distributor, Robert, and he was telling me the new 404 might be coming in. So lucky I was able to get a 404, so this was one of the very first 404s that came to Singapore. So this is the current generation Zip 404 Firecrest. And you're running on Schwabel Pro 1 tires. So it's a very, very fast setup. Right now, in this current setup, I've slammed the stem. I'm running a 110 right now in front, although I normally run a 120, so I'm testing it out right now. So that's why you have a little bit of a cap on top. I call it my my teh tarik holder, which works well. And it has basically about 2,500 kilometers on it so far.
Right. So just looking at the setup, even I was telling you just now, It looks like you look like a very pro rider. The way this is set up is tailored to you. Before we go down into the specs and the questions that I have, what is the weight of the bike?
Okay, this bike right now in its current setup is about around almost 7.8 kilograms. That means that includes the light mountings and pedals and the Garmin mount without the Garmin.
And what is your height and the frame size? 52?
Okay, I'm about 1.73 centimeters. The frame size is 52 cm. So I've been riding 52s for donkey years. This is not my first Specialized. I've been riding Specialized for a very long time, since the first generation Tarmac.
Wow. So why a Venge then?
Very simply because I wanted. Okay, this is not my first bike, and this is not my only bike, and I wanted a fast aero bike. And actually, my brother had a Venge, and he was riding quite well in it. So I thought maybe good bike to try. I was either this or the Austro actually, lo and behold, I was able to get a pretty good deal on this Venge. So Venge. Anyway, right. I've been a Specialized fan, so I'll admit that.
What is the full build, the price of the full build?
Based on this total build right now, with the wheels, with the carbon TI and all that, the cost is about, and the Power 2 Max, which I got a pretty good deal on, it's about around 15 grand.
Let's talk about the Power 2 Max. Why a crank-based power meter? And because everyone I interviewed, they have a Favero. So have you considered a Favero, and why the crankbase?
Okay, so Faveros are nice and actually more recent in technology. Crankbase are basically bread and butter. They've been a very stable kind of system. This is not my first power to max, this is my second power to max. I find that they are very, very stable. If you train, you want a stable power meter that gives you relatively good power. And so far, to be honest, the gold standard is SRM. But power to max isn't too far back. Made in Germany, which is not too bad. Crankbase, so they are very reliable. They don't have much problems. A bit heavier in today's standards, but generally speaking, it works. So it works, and it's part of my, if I use it for my training, and it's fine. So good, no issues there.
Being a veteran in the sport, I have to ask you, where is the oversized pulley?
Actually, I don't believe in oversized pulleys. I've been riding for over 30 over years, but 20 years in more or less a very competitive manner. And I've played with a lot of stuff. And what I've learned, to be honest, is stock is good. Don't go too off-board if you can. I mean, yes, I do have a funny chain ring right now, which is a carbon fiber chain ring, but there's a long story behind it, which is more of the fact that I couldn't find a AXS compatible chain ring to match the power to max, and this was the only one available at that point of time. Praxis makes a new one currently, but I couldn't find it. So the only one you could get is the carbon TI. But generally speaking, my philosophy is I like to ride and I like equipment that works. So stock works because when it's built to work together as a complete set. When you change anything from that complete set, there are compatibility issues, and you have to be very careful about those, especially with the new technology that's coming out. I didn't know that the SRAM RAID, for example, runs a slightly different, the AXS runs a slightly different chain, which is a flat top chain. Now, it's not just a flat top chain. The flat top chain has larger bearings or rollers in there, which do not fit normal Shimano style chain rings, which means that it has to work with a SRAM AXS compatible chain ring, which is very different from just slapping on a normal 11 speed. Last time when you had 10, 11, or even 9, 10, 11, you could actually use the same chain ring for all those systems. But once you go 12, especially with SRAM, I know the new Shimano 12s are compatible, or the cranks are compatible with the old 11s. But the SRAMs, that's very unique. So,
wow.
The long and short story is, stock is good.
Okay, and you've owned, you say you're a Specialized fan, and you've owned different Specialized models.
Yes.
May I know which Specialized models?
So I've had, I started riding Specialized many years ago from the first generation Tarmac, so from the SLs, all the way to the current SLs, well, to the SL6. I've not ridden the seven yet. I've never had a 7 yet, but I had Tarmac the original SL, the two SL2s, SL3s, SL4s, SL5s, which was one of my favorite bikes. The SL6, rim brake, it didn't go disc. And then I also had the first generation Venge. I didn't go second gen Venge because I thought they were damn ugly.
The Vios. Yeah, it's ugly, man.
It's damn ugly and it's damn heavy. And somewhat of a weight weenie. So when this came out, I was like, hey, they got smarter. And this is a much lighter bike than the Vios. And they were saying that it's just as aero, so yeah. That was the reason why I said, okay, I can buy this again.
Right. Sorry to Alistair, because I filmed one of my guys who on the channel, he had a Vios. I honestly told him I don't like the frame. It was just weird. It's just too many things going on, you know, the down tube and
The cabling and all that. So I'm actually quite particular about cabling. So I've had bikes like the old Cervelo S3, which is the first generation S3s. And cabling, to be honest, when it runs internally, you have to be very careful because you can get really, and that was mechanical shifting. That time, really, DI2 was still in infancy. I like things to be clean. And the Vios looks very messy inside. Really, I looked at the bike, I was like, wow. Everything is proprietary. Everything has to run like, kind of weird. The Specialized was still at its infancy in terms of this aero stuff. So I'm very sure that they made the most aero bike they could build, but without all the practical aspects of it. And I think that, if I remember correctly, a lot of pros hated it. Pro mechanics hated it because it was very difficult to build
and
maintain.
Right. So what do you think of the new SL7?
I think SL7 looks pretty nice. I actually had a chat with a friend of mine who had both the Venge and the SL7, and I asked him, hey, if I want to go back to ride a Specialized, what do you think? Should I go Venge or SL7? So he asked me the question, ride in Singapore or ride overseas? I said, ride in Singapore, Venge.
Mm.
So the reason is because the SL7 is a more all-rounder bike, but Singapore is relatively flat. So riding a Venge actually is more suitable in a sense for Singapore, and that's why I put in the 404s. Normally I don't run 58s. These are pretty difficult wheels to push if you're outside of Singapore. And I've lived outside of Singapore before, I've ridden outside of Singapore before. Let's put it this way, give you a bit of background. I used to have an original first generation Venge living in Taiwan. I hated that bike. The reason why I hated the bike was every time when it came to big hills, mountains, okay, the bike's fast, but it's very, very hard going up mountains. So what I did was I brought it back to Singapore, kept it in Singapore as my Singapore bike. When I got it in Singapore and rode it in Singapore, I realized that, wow, this bike's really very fast. Very, very nice to ride. And then I realized that the bike actually should suit the terrain that you're in. And when I had the Venge in Singapore, that was one of my most favorite bikes to ride in Singapore. As when I was riding in Taiwan, wasn't nice lah. Yeah. Let's put it this way, I wouldn't go up Wuling in that bike.
Right, right. This SL7, I'm sorry, I actually like Specialized as a brand and the bikes that they come out. I just think the Vias, the SL7 were... not a fan of the bikes, especially the SL7, because, I mean, one bike rules them all, right? And
yes.
The way it's set up, it's a hybrid between an SL6 and a Venge, if I'm not
correct.
Wrong. Just don't think it should be that way, man. I think aero bike, just stick as a Venge and, you know...
Yeah, so if you want to go fast, stick with this. If you want to climb, then get something else. But then, really, to each his own. I mean, if you have one bike,
yeah,
then the SL7 would make a lot of sense. I kind of have a little bit more than one bike, so so I do have some choices in that sense. And I do have a climbing bike. It's not a Specialized,
yeah,
but it climbs really very well and it rolls very well. I've taken that bike up Wuling, taken that bike down Wuling, and runs perfectly well.
Yeah.
That's a different story, lah. I mean, right. When you have time.
You probably know the answer to this, but I've tried bringing this bike up to Faber Sentosa, and I struggle with it. Is it me or is it the bike?
I think, to be honest, my personal view is that, okay, the bike is a hard bike, okay? And when they built the Venge, to be a bike to go fast. My current setup is meant to go fast. If I want to take it, by the way, I've done Faber on this. I've done southern bumps on it where I just ride on this and can go up no problem. I think the issue is, to be honest, the wheels. If you get a good pair of wheels, for example, these are 58s, so maybe the 303 S or Firecrest might be a better wheel to travel. But at end of the day, to be honest, like, engine very important.
Indirectly, you're saying I cannot climb lah.
No lah, not that lah. I mean, I also have to suffer. I mean, this bike, to be honest, okay, like yesterday when I went to ride with this bike with some of my friends, this bike suffers from two problems. One problem. It takes what, because of the wheels and also I guess the way the bike is set up, it takes a while to accelerate.
Yes, yes.
And the Venge has that so-called reputation. It's good only once you hit a certain speed, especially with these wheels. But once you hit that speed, oh boy, it just keeps on rolling. So whenever my friend wants to go, it's things like this, traffic light stops, voila, suffer. Or short bumps where he puts the power down, you suffer, because it takes a while to build momentum. But once you build the momentum, it's not saying it goes slow. But the way I put it this way, ride to the strength of the bike, rather than you trying to wrestle the bike. That's, I think, a more practical way of doing it.
Yeah, I have to agree, because I find the bike, like what you said, at traffic lights, I struggle a little bit.
Yeah.
But I have to get off saddle, just push it a little bit.
Just push it a little bit,
yeah.
And then it will start rolling.
Yeah.
And once it starts rolling, once you get to about around 25, 30, the speed comes in.
Yeah.
And the beauty of this bike is that once it hits 35 and above, for. It's very nice to ride.
Yeah.
So I mean, you need to know what are the strengths, what are the weaknesses of the bike.
Right.
I mean, one of the reasons why I bought this bike was when I was following my brother with the previous his Venge. I realized when we're on long straights and you just keep going, it's like, oh man, when is it gonna tire?
Yeah.
Just keep going. It's like, okay.
Yeah.
So it has its strength, it has its weakness.
Yeah, and just now when we're looking at the bike, you have some very quirky tips or something that you stick on top of the bolts, which is an electrical tape.
Yes.
And I guess that it was meant to prevent sweat from eroding the bolt.
Correct. So a small pro tip, you want to look at it this way. So instead of having, you know, leaving your bolts exposed sometimes, it is good to kind of, I use a bit of electrical tape to cover it. It's light, it doesn't weigh much more. But at the same time, it prevents any sweat from getting into it. So as a trick, as I mentioned to you, I put a little bit of a loop of PTFE to coat the bolt and then tape it on top. So it saves your bolts. And I've had many a chance where I couldn't take the seat post off. So you still have to take a seat post once in a while. But every 6 months, just unscrew, take it out, put it back in,
yeah.
put some whatever carbon paste on it just to make sure it's fine.
Yeah, that's true. Actually, I swear by that. Try to take it out once in a while. Just like what you say, clean it up, put some carbon paste. Because if you just leave it there, it just seize.
You'll seize.
And then you end up destroying your seat post. Correct. And everything is going
to
be gone.
Has happened to me on two bikes already.
Wow.
So I'm fully aware of that. And my mechanic keeps on telling me, hey, you're sweat like shit.
Let's talk about the old debate, rim versus disc. You've been riding some time, this is a disc. I'm assuming you've ridden rim for sure.
Yes.
What is take?
Okay, I would say this would most probably be the future. Let me tell you a story. Okay, I had an aha moment about three years ago. This was in 2018, where I rode up Wuling with some friends of mine on a Giant TCR Pro disc bike. Not the current generation, the previous generation. Ran up the mountain, which was very nice. We hit the peak. And then at the top, I had friends. There was a car following us. There were about five of us. And we realized that at the top of the mountain, there were only seats for three people to get down, to get in the car and go down. So two of us had to go down. So one of them was a pro. So the pro went on his own, no problem. He's on rim brakes, no problem. And oh, by the way, at the top of the mountain, it started to rain. So of all the guys, I was the only guy on disc brakes. Okay? And so what my friend, so short straw lah. Hey, everybody on rim, right? You're on disc, right? So I'm on disc brakes. So this is wet, this is 3275. Okay, and I'm going down Wuling. Initially, it was a bit scary because it's wet. You know, you still have to get grip. These tires is one thing, but braking has always been a problem because I've done Wuling in the wet, going downhill. We went halfway and then we stopped. There's no way to stop. There's no way to go down on a rim brake, especially carbon rim brakes. No way, impossible in the wet. Because you could potentially hit a barrier and fly over, and it's a steep cliff going down. You most probably will not survive. I had the aha moment when I was going down here. I started to follow cars. And I started following cars on my disc brakes. I realized that the modulation on this is unbelievable. I mean, you know these are good. But you only realize how good they are only when you're doing such things where you're going down a mountain 50, 60 kilometers an hour in the wet. And you're following cars. And you can start passing cars. When you start feeling, okay, I've got some confidence now. I mean, you start busting cars, and that was my aha moment. So, okay, so I know it will be the future. Now, I like rim brakes because number one, they're easy to maintain. Number two, it's old school, and I do have a little bit of call it nostalgia about that. So yes, the long and short is that I would say this will be the future. But I hope they don't stop making rim brakes.
Right, but it might come to a point where the manufacturers see that, you know, everyone's buying this, just stop production of rim, right? So don't waste money.
True lah. I think that, as you know, the current generation of Dura Ace, there is still rim brakes, but SRAM, they still make rim brakes. So it's still possible, but a lot of the new manufacturers, high-end bikes, don't make rim brakes anymore. I know that for a fact, Specialized doesn't make rim brakes for their high-end bikes. All the S-Works will be this.
So we move on to the Instagram Q&A. If you guys want to ask your questions, follow me on Instagram and you get the chance to ask a question. So the first question, after slamming your stem, do you look at others who don't slam and try to get them to slam their stem?
No. I think that positioning and fit is actually most important. And all this riding that I've done, the reason why I can slam the stem is because I've been riding long enough and I know my position and my geometry.
No.
It's good aesthetically to slam the stem, but if you can't sustain that position for long, then it actually has no reason for you to slam the stem.
True.
So to be honest, comfort is actually more important than just aesthetics. I mean, in my view.
Yeah, when I first started cycling, I saw all the pros having a very slam position and long handle, long stems. I tried to copy them. And you're right, I can't even do 100 kilometers. Like, wow, my back was back pain. Yeah. And then, you know, my arms were so tired because you're trying to maintain that position.
Correct.
For so long, right?
Correct.
I learned my lesson and I didn't do that.
So, to each his own, that's what I would say.
Yeah. Next question, how many times have you dropped your chain on this on a SRAM and this chain ring?
Actually, none so far. It's been relatively stable so far in terms of dropping. I've not had a drop chain right now on this, and I've got about maybe 2.5k on it already, so not too bad.
Is it a well-known thing that chain drops on SRAM? Because people always ask me that question.
Yes, it is well-known. When I had the first gen E-Tech, I kept dropping chain. And then I talked to a mechanic, and basically it's set up with the front derailleur. So once the setup is correct, normally it should hold its position. I don't even have a chain catcher for this bike, to be honest.
Oh, wow. I got a chain catcher because I was sort of an insurance. I had an issue with my SL6, it dropped, and I chipped the paint.
Yeah, I know. That's always a problem.
Yeah.
It sucks, man.
What is your front and rear tire pressure?
Okay, Zip has a requirement that you cannot build. I think the maximum, I think, is 70 PSI. So I run about, if I'm not wrong, 53 at the front and about 58 at the back. For this setup.
Wait, 53 PSI?
53 PSI in front, 50 at the back.
Wow, okay.
Okay, so I normally, if I'm going for longer rides, I'll run about around 60, 65 at the back and about 60 in front.
Are these tubulars?
Tubeless.
Wow, that's very low pressure.
Yes. Yeah, so these, okay, so the new Firecrest are only tubeless, and Zip has, and these are hookless. So they are tubeless, hookless. Mm. So for the new tubeless, hookless wheels, number one is that you need to run Zip approved tires. The Schauber Pro ones are, and you can only run it up to maximum of 78. I can't remember, I need to double check, but you can Google it and find out. But I believe it's about 70 or 75 PSI. And if not, the tires will blow off.
Oh, that is super low because I run very, very, very high pressure. It's a clincher and it's a hook rim. It's on NVs and a GP5000. I run 115.
Yeah, you don't really need to. I mean, actually, the technology about Zips is this, or the new technology is that it's not about just going aero, but it's how to go, it's going fast. If you run too heavy a pressure, especially if you're a light rider like you, you run at 115 or maybe even 110, what happens is that you end up bouncing, and because there's no give. Actually, the new philosophy is this: if you run a slightly lower pressure, you actually run faster because the tires actually give you a bit of suspension. It's like car suspension. So with that, you're actually able to ride faster, and also at the same time, the Venge, by the way, is a very hard wheel, hard bike, so it beats you up. So by running a lower pressure, actually there's less
vibrations
going through the body because the tires are eating that vibration off. So it might, I mean, if you think about the logic and the theory behind it, lower vibration means also lower stress on the body, means your body is fresher, you can ride longer. So if you based on that, I think then, and so far I'm running, okay, I'm running about around 58 at max, 60 at max at for these wheels. I did have one problem which cost me one tire, and that was because I ran too low. I was running about almost 40 plus and I hit a hole, and it caused the tire to be cut, which meant the tire was then trashed, and that tire was very new, only less than 100k. So
right.
One of these problems with this wheel set is that you gotta be not too high, but then yet not too low. So the long and short is that you should be within. There's a tire calculator. Just go and check.
Venge or tarmac?
For Singapore, Venge.
Venge.
Overseas, maybe not.
How do you rate the 303s? These are 404s.
These are 404s.
Sorry, how do you rate the 404s? Maybe the guy didn't know it's a 404.
Okay, so the 404s, to be honest, are really fast wheels. They make a really nice sound when you're rolling very fast. And I would say that these are one of the fastest. Okay, these are not my first 404s. I've had a few generations of 404s. These are one of the fastest 404s I've ever had. Not the fastest 404 I've ever had.
Okay.
A bit potty, but that was part of the whole idea. The 303s initially was what I wanted to put on these, but aesthetically it was either the 404s or the Rover at CLX,
right.
CLX 50s, but CLX 50 is very hard to find nowadays.
Yeah. How does this wheel compare against a DT Swiss die cut? I don't know, I never heard of a DT Swiss die cut.
Okay. To answer that question is that I don't know, because I've never had a DT Swiss before. I've had 303, I'm running actually on a different bike, a 303S. I've had the KDX 42s, which are on the Giant. I've run old Roval CLX 50 rim brakes. These are the fastest wheels I've ever had, based on all those wheels I've used before. I've not tried the die cut. But they are also a bit more potty, so it takes a bit of a while to build up speed, that's all.
Is this your fastest aero bike by far?
Yes, apparently.
Okay. Wow. Do you get angry at SL7s for killing the model, and will you take revenge?
To each his own. I won't diss the SL7s because I'm a specialized fan. But I think for me, this is the bike I would like to ride in Singapore.
Mm.
That's all I can say.
Why SRAM instead of a Shimano?
So this is a interesting philosophy I have. The way I do it is I try and keep things consistent. So currently, all my 12 speeds are SRAM. So I'm going SRAM. Easier for me to switch wheels, easier for me to switch cassettes. It's easier for me to, you know, spare parts are interchangeable. So all my 11s are rim. All my discs are 12.
How are the zip hubs? Durian Rider, another YouTuber, doesn't seem to like their quality too much.
Hub, as this is the sort of the gold standard out there, and we'll just position it up like that. And you can sort of see here we have this is zip quality. And this was sent back for warranty, but I didn't get any warranty love. I'd sent it back too late. I'd been traveling and, you know, stuffing around like that, so I should send it back earlier, but they said no warranty, which is sort of not too bad, because even if they did warranty, they'd just give me the same hub again.
I'm a Zip fan, so I can tell you that the first the previous generation 188 188 hubs are loud. Okay, I never had big problems with it, but you always need to tighten them once in a while because they tend to loosen up. The current 177, and currently this is the ZR1 or ZR2 hubs. That problem has kind of gone away. And to be honest, I've never had any problems with my zip hubs. I mean, I've got this, which is the new ZR1s. I've had the 303S, which is using the cheaper version of the hubs. And I'm clocking decent mileage on it, and not okay, the only problem is that bearing wear. And that one is wear and tear lah. So that one, once in a while, you gotta bring it back, take out the hub. I mean, either you replace the bearings or whatever not. But never really had any problems with in that sense that, you know, things are seizing up and anything of that sort.
Mm. He always see comments mentioning that the Venge is not a comfy bike. Is that true?
I think the answer is it has a very strong half-truth to it, or true to it to a certain extent. The Venge has always had a reputation of being a hard bike, which is true. You just need to know how to ride it. There is a saying, 车不可以比人凶. So all I can say is that as long as you know what the bike is about and what it you can and what cannot do with it, then it's fine. I mean, I've had Pinas before, and Pinas have a very, very bad, I won't say bad reputation, but a very similar reputation, and they are very, very hard bikes. And if you're not fit or you're not strong enough, normally within, okay, the current generation Pinas are much better, of course, but the old Pinas of old, right, if you're not fit or you're not strong, they tend to break you within 30 to 40 kilometers.
Mm. I actually interviewed someone this morning and he told me he owned the F8, and he told me he sold the bike because it was too stiff for him.
Yeah. That was my most fun bike I've ever had.
Really?
for Pina. So I had an F8.
Yeah.
So I have a lot of bikes actually. So I sold it about a few months ago. That was one of the most fun Pinas I've ever had. I mean, I have not ridden 10 or the 12, but the F8s are so much more comfortable versus the old Dogmas of yesteryears.
Mm.
I mean, the 65.1 and all that, those are very, very hard to ride. I mean, as you say, you just need to know the bikes are stiff. And the reason why they're stiff is because they're pro-level bikes. These are raced by the pros. I mean, so they're built to race, and they're race bikes. So, of course, the performance is there. But then, because of that, as I was talking about vibration, same thing. The Venge will bring a lot of vibration. Because it's a stiff bike, it's a hard bike, you will feel the vibration. And that's where you get tired, that's where you get fatigued.
Mm.
It's not about... And so, in a sense that you need to be of a certain fitness level, I'm not saying that I'm fit, but you have a certain fitness level to be able to handle the bike. And once you have that fitness level, then actually, that's fine. I mean, the pros ride it, they can ride it for 200 kilometers, they can race classics on it. So it's not say it's impossible, it's just that I would say that you have to the bike has to fit your level of riding to a certain extent.
Okay. That is the end of the questions.
Okay.
I know you brought another bike for us, let's do that one.
Sure.
So thank you for showcasing this bike.
Welcome.
Let's do the other one, and you guys want to feature your bike on my channel, do follow me on Instagram and DM me, and see you guys in the next video. Thank you.